This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
But today we're going down a dark path, but with a person who knows how to lead us safely along that curving, dark way. Her name is Dr. Heather Lynn. She's a historian and a renegade archaeologist. She's on a quest to uncover the truth behind ancient mysteries. She left a life in academia to pursue her interest in the unexplained, and she investigates ancient mysteries. You've probably heard her from time to time on Coast to Coast. She works on ancient aliens. She's the author of The Sumerian Controversy and Land of the Watchers. You can reach her at drheatherlynn.com. That's drheatherlynn.com. And her latest book is Evil Archaeology, Demons, Possessions, and Sinister Relics. Heather, welcome to Dreamland. Or shall I call you Dr. Lynn?
Oh, you can call me Heather. Thank you.
Okay. All right. You left academia. You were an established academic. Why did you do that?
Well, for a lot of reasons, actually. I started off in community college, and so I didn't have that sort of ivory tower experience. So I think I went in feeling a little, like a regular person. And so I went in, under that. And then I was really struck by a lot of corruption that I saw around me as I got further into my education. One of the things that really sort of inspired me was, it was my first archaeology class, literally Archaeology 101. And we were asked to debunk a list of what they called pseudo archaeologists. And on the board that they had for us to choose from, I recognized many of the names. And I thought, wow, these are individuals who I had been listening to on late night radio shows, and I've read their books. And while I may not agree with all of their theories or assertions, I didn't feel comfortable calling them pseudo-archaeologists just because they maybe didn't have credentials, or if they did have credentials, they were simply speaking about issues that went against the mainstream historic narrative. So that was one of the first things that I thought was interesting. And I thought, well, they're just having us do this to exercise our discourse and debate skills and maybe look for, critical thinking but that wasn't what was told to us. I was giving them the benefit of the doubt when the professor said, well, we're doing this because what we need to do is assert our own authority. And that was like, well, I still was a little apologetic here and there, but it just was a number of things after that. And then I started getting more involved as I got older and I got into my undergraduate and my graduate. I started seeing through our archaeology lab a lot of corruption in terms of grant funding and things that were not very transparent and a lot of political infighting. And I refer to it as the academic industrial complex. It's a system now where they're just churning out people and taking government money out of loans. And it's just most of the material that we have that we can research is kept away from the public. If it's not kept away from the public behind paywalls or very expensive academic databases that you only have as a professor or access to as an alumni, times at libraries, depending on which municipality pays for which services. If you don't have those barriers to access, what you have are barriers such as academese, so a language form that they'll commonly use when they publish different academic journals that are very, very exclusive and very difficult for the layperson to sort of wrap their heads around. Or if anything, it's just very discouraging because it's dry and boring. So there's multiple filtration systems, and that isn't even just the things that are available. There's even more in the private sector of archaeology that people keep to themselves. And so that's when I started really working against it, when I saw that a lot of times the universities were being funded as sort of arms, long arms of the elites who simply wanted to collect antiquities. And so this was something that I really, it just didn't sit well with me. Midway through this point, actually early on, I started feeling disgruntled a little, and I actually reached out to Michael Cremo, author of Forbidden Archaeology.
Oh, yeah, I know Michael, and he has been on this radio program before many times. We have to just hold off for a minute, and there's a good reason for it, Free Dreamlanders. And since you listen, most of you, every week and have for a long time, this is what it is. Listen up. We're talking to Dr. Heather Lynn about evil archaeology, demons, possessions, and sinister relics. Her website is drheatherlynn.com. That's drheatherlynn.com. And it is an excellent website. You can get Dr. Lynn's books through the website from Barnes & Noble, from Amazon, from IndieBound. So do visit her website. There's also an extensive blog. It's interesting stuff, and she's into this deeply, deeply. And I want to shift gears a little bit. We've talked enough about the problems with the academic community, and we all know what they are, and or at least we do now, since you've explained it to us. But your book, your new book, is called Evil Archaeology. Why that title?
Well, I think it has to do with my question initially when starting this sort of research. I was interested in the question of evil. A lot of times archaeologists will find artifacts and things that may seem scary. There are so many different, whether it be demonic statues or statues of deities or even just odd arrangements of human remains. There's just this question that people have that, you know, some of these archaeological excavations can come across as creepy. And sometimes the archaeological community, they don't really want to put those things out there because they don't want to sensationalize it, which is, you know, understandable. But something that got me was, as silly as it is, it was the movie The Exorcist. In the beginning scene from both the book and the movie, it's set in Iraq in an archaeological excavation. At the site, a priest archaeologist feels the strong wind blowing. It's foreshadowing the arrival of Pazuzu, demon of the southwestern wind and bearer of storms and drought in Assyrian and Babylonian mythology. This is the demon statue figured, featured on the cover of Evil Archaeology, actually. So in the Exorcist, Pazuzu is the demon that possessed the main character. And so as an archaeologist, the opening scene sort of piqued my interest in it. Made me wonder about the relationship between the demons of ancient Mesopotamia and how we see demons now. And it was sort of intriguing. But then it wasn't long after seeing that movie again that I read a news story about a man in North Carolina who actually changed his name to Pazuzu so that he could honor the demon. He went on to murder and cannibalize his neighbors. And it was really, I cover the whole story in Evil Archaeology. It's a really gruesome true crime that made me think about maybe Mesopotamian demons could still be dwelling among us, maybe even possessing people, as odd as it sounds. But it was something that I thought, what constitutes this sort of idea of possession? What does it take to be possessed? Can you simply be inspired? Because inspired from the Latin inspirare means to breathe into. So a supernatural being, for it to impart an idea or to breathe an idea into you, that's being inspired by, would that be enough to constitute what we would see as possession? And so these are sort of the things I wondered and I thought about as I went through this book to look for any evidence of evil in the archaeological and historical record. And I bring that into more contemporary accounts of possession. I interview an exorcist, paranormal investigator, and I look at ways that science is currently trying to figure out maybe if there is such a thing as demonic possession.
So can you say that you think that there are other entities that we no longer really believe in? Because, for example, in the book you you bring up epilepsy and the beliefs in the past about that and other things as well, along those lines, which we now understand as medical issues rather than demonic possession. But since they didn't understand what they were, they tried to explain them as best they could, and this is what they came up with. Is there something behind it, though? That's what I'm curious about, what your thinking is. And I'm wondering if maybe we have suppressed something by learning how things work, really work. I mean, we've hidden something from ourselves.
That's a really great point. Yes, I do think that you're pretty much hitting the nail on the head. We do know that there are these ideas of possession in the past have, and even in the current day, they seem to be linked to things we would call, you know, mental disorders or even diseases of the brain, epilepsy, and these sorts of things. And so there's definitely a physical component, and a lot of these things can be explained simply using medical science. But that's something when you look back again into the Sumerian culture, how interesting it is that they also thought that, yet they still had this belief in demons and entities in this way. When you look at the Sumerian record, the tablets that are held currently in the British Museum on medical texts, they were the textbooks used to teach the Sumerian scribes all of the different ways to heal people. And it was a very organized system. They actually had to go through and get a sort of licensing. So they really did care about what they taught. So they had these medical texts. Out of 1,000 of them that we have held at the British Museum, 660 of those specifically reference exorcism. So they didn't sort of make the two things, you know, there wasn't this body and mind separation so much. So what they did was they looked at the demons and the exorcism as sort of a healing practice, something that you also still see in different cultures with shamanic practices. But that's how they looked at it. And so this idea in popular culture where a priest or, you know, typically an exorcist will demand to know the name of a demon, that actually comes from the Sumerian way of having exorcisms. They would demand to know the name of the demon. But the reason they did this was because it was as though they were trying to get the diagnosis. Once you knew the name of the demon or what that demon was responsible for doing to the patient, you would be able to properly heal the patient using whatever sort of herbs or medicinal treatment. So that's something that, you know, while there are definitely medical reasons for this and not everything is spiritual, it does make you wonder about, well, how separate now that in modernity we've sort of divided the body and mind and we take a more reductionist approach to things as opposed to a holistic one. So can we actually be missing something? So you may have these medical issues, but could there perhaps be something else? And that's something that in Morocco, scientists have been studying since about the 1990s. They actually have a theory that certain diseases define certain afflictions and that it has to do with the penetration of demonic spirits into the human body in the physical mechanism comparable to microbes. So it's sort of like a germ theory of demonology that they're currently trying to test. And so it's quite fascinating that, you know, they've even been able to devise mathematic formulas and computational, models to predict and calculate the movements and behaviors of what they think are demons in the body. And so they think that this would explain why demons appear at night or in the dark. They think that they perhaps are averse to light, that they have their own special physical laws and life cycles and can rapidly multiply after entering the bloodstream. And so, I mean, they've developed this whole sort of theoretical framework to try to understand demons and this sort of idea of spirit. So they've not separated it from medicine so much, and that's what they're looking at now. So I think it's an interesting, you know, way of looking at it. So to sort of look at things in a more holistic way and actually perform scientific investigation on it. And so there it is being done currently.
Well, you know, it's interesting that you say this. You know, I think we're going to take another break. This is Whitley Strieber. We're talking to Dr. Heather Lynn. Her book, Evil Archaeology, Demons, Possessions, and Sinister Relics, her website, drheatherlynn.com, where you can get a free ebook. So give drheatherlynn.com a visit and get your free ebook. We'll be right back.
Ever wonder what the close encounter experience is all about? Think you know what it's about? When you open Whitley and Ann Strieber's Immortal Communion Letters, you're going to experience a whole new vision. Not something being told to us by researchers and theorists, but the actual testimony of people who came face to face with this unknown. Unforgettable. And the book is only $3.99 at Strieber.com.
You know where you can go to find all my books? Well, that would be Strieber.com. You can click through to Strieber.com and get all of the ebooks, all of the hardcovers, all of the softcovers that are in print, and I would not miss it. It's a beautiful site, and it's got a lot to offer. There's a lot of Whitley Strieber out there at this point in time. Don't miss it. Get on the journey. It's a really interesting one, at least from my standpoint. Yeah, it has been quite something. We're talking to Dr. Heather Lynn about evil archaeology, demons, possessions, and sinister relics. And we have assumed in modern times that disease and adversity have basically what I would describe as secular explanations. If you have epilepsy, it's because of a problem with your brain. If your country or city is ruined by some kind of dreadful storm or a fire, as happened to a lot of my friends up in Malibu a few months ago, it's a natural event, a natural disaster, or perhaps a man-made disaster in some cases, but not demonic. Where do you stand on this?
Yeah, I think that the belief in an external world independent of the perceiving subject is sort of the basis of all natural science. But the sense of perception only gives information about the external world or physical reality indirectly. I mean, we can only grasp the latter by, say, speculative means. So it really has to do with our senses. We're limited by our senses, and we're limited by the tools of science that we have. So I'm really open to this idea that there is so much more beyond what we can perceive with our current senses and what we can perceive with our methodologies and scientific tools. And so I think it's one of these things where we really have to be open and look for these ideas. But you said it best with the secularization of things. While it's important to, you know, to some degree, have that in way that you're using science and you're trying to be objective and unbiased, it doesn't mean, in my opinion, that all questions of the spiritual should just be thrown out. I think that, you know, this is exactly why we do science, is to answer those seemingly unanswerable questions. And so I look at it like these things are all fair game. We really need to start looking at this, and maybe not in such a religious mindset. So when people say spirit, people say religion, sometimes it just makes people cringe because they're afraid of their own pre-existing religious dogma being upset. But that's not what I'm talking about either. I'm just saying that if we go into things sort of with the idea that there's more than what we're able to perceive or measure currently, and we don't have to label it, we can just say there is more. And I think that will open us up to a whole new world of understanding. And one of my favorite quotes is from Galileo, and he said, "All truths are easy to understand once they are discovered. The point is to discover them." So I think the question really lies in discovery. And if we are just so secularized or jaded or reductionist, then we lose our motivation, I believe, to discover. I think we just are then looking to quantify, and not everything is quantifiable, especially in the world of spirit.
Now, let's get into a little bit of the nitty-gritty here. One of the things that people have been trying to do for a long time is to summon demons. Aleister Crowley, classic example. And you discuss this in a very, very interesting way in your book. And let's talk about the idea of the intentional possession ritual and why somebody might want to do that.
Yeah, this is something that I wasn't prepared for when I was researching the book. We're just sort of conditioned to think that demonic possession is so terrible, and we wouldn't want any part of that. Until you start looking into the literature and the records, and you start finding that there are plenty of people, and not just the sort of bad guys of the past, like Aleister Crowley or those. You start to see that there are natives and shamans and people of all sorts, even people from the Bible, like King Solomon, who somehow, some way, believe that it would be a good thing to have possession, or at least summon these demonic entities. Sometimes it would be in an effort to control them or put them to work for themselves. Often that would be the case. And so I found that to come up in not just Western culture, but a lot of different indigenous cultures as well. And that was something I wasn't prepared to find, because I would think, well, who would want at all to be possessed or have any of these things? But there comes a lot of different reasons for this. So some native practices, they believe that if they were to summon these entities into themselves, that they could somehow, you know, bring the typical sort of nature responses or outcomes that they look for. So better rain or harvest crops, this sort of thing. But then you have people like, you know, the Aleister Crowley or the occultists that are looking to really summon these entities and put them to work. So like Solomon, who would summon jinn to help build his temple, people would sometimes summon thought forms. These things could be conjured in a variety of ways. And it comes from this sort of Tibetan occult belief that thought forms can happen because the will is strong enough to sort of materialize them. And these thought forms can even survive their creators and turn up in next lives. And so it's as though your will and intent and desire is so strong that it projects this being or this thought form out there that can just become so strong that it outlives you, and it can have its own karmic cycle, and it can just keep having rebirth and all these things. And so it's I think the common link to all of this is this desire for man to harness these powers and do something with them. What I have found, though, from the tales in history and the account and legend and story, is that it never really works out well for anybody. Anybody doing this, they have a lot of great results in the beginning, and even if they master it and they make these thought forms or summon the jinn, they usually end up regretting it, because they think that they're powerful enough to outwit these entities. And I think the entities have been known as tricksters for quite some time, and rightfully so, because they sort of lull these occultists or people like this into a sense of complacency or feeling that they have mastered, you know, have dominance over these entities. And then when they're complacent, the entities will strike back somehow and usually make them worse off than had they not. So in the case of Solomon, he was the richest and wisest man, you know, in the world. But then when the jinn weren't so happy with him, they struck him down and made him the poorest. And he it was a tragic figure. So this is just something that you see oftentimes when you have people dabbling or even going full force into trying to summon these entities. So I think it might be quite dangerous if you look at the historical record.
Yeah, well, it seems like a rather dangerous thing to do, a little bit like trying to dance with a tiger. Yeah. Now, where do demons come from?
That's the million-dollar question, I think. Demons that we are aware of, I think it's a question of semantics, really, because if you look at sort of the image on my book of Pazuzu, if you look at these figures that we'll get in the archaeological excavation.
They're horrifying, really scary.
They're horrible, absolutely. I think what happens is, in the past, you'll find people who, you know, they're making these images. These are what they believe the demons to look like. And if you notice, a lot of them are sort of chimeras. They capture all of the sort of instinctual fears that we have. Their large teeth and claws, and they're very powerful and frightening. And there's sort of a bestial component, but they're not simply animals. They're animal and they're a human animal type hybrid. So it really just strikes us at a deep level of fear. But I think what you'll have then are, you know, these entities that in the past weren't always looked at as just purely evil. So again, with Pazuzu, you would certainly not want Pazuzu around. You wouldn't want to summon that thing. But if you were a pregnant woman in ancient Sumer, you would have actually worn a Pazuzu necklace or slept with a Pazuzu plaque next to your bed. And this was because although he was an evil demon, he could also be used as protection against the demon responsible for miscarriage and sudden infant death. And this demon was Lamashtu, and it was his wife who was believed to steal babies out of jealousy because she couldn't have children of her own. And so being a dominant husband as he was, he would have to whip his wife, you know, into shape and discipline her. So this is why you would have so many of these statues found, is they were very popular and people actually wanted some of these particular demons around them. So, you know, you get these and it starts to become like a cult practice or something very popular. So over time, you start to see different religions and syncretism where, you know, they will literally demonize those pagan deities. You can see that in the case of Pan, the ancient Greek figure represented nature, fertility, music, and drunkenness, these sorts of things. And eventually the Christian church would use the figure of Pan to illustrate, you know, the bad things that could happen when you're sexually immoral or uncivilized or unrepentant. So the idea of Pan's horns and cloven hooves and wild appearance ended up being the archetypal form attributed to devils as the church sort of engaged in a widespread transformation of paganism to Christianity. So we have this case where there's these ancient statues and figures and depictions of demons, and they become demonized, and we look at these as, okay, these are demons. And so it's a little tricky, because what happens, since we have those rich archetypal now images stuck in our minds, if somebody were to tell you now, hey, I think so-and-so was possessed by a demon, and if you're a person of contemporary time, and you may say, oh, that's preposterous. Of course, there's not these little red figures running around or something. And so you could easily discount that. Whereas it's not very fair, because where did these images come from anyway? You know, people have these shared experiences where they see, I guess, creatures, for lack of a better term. And so what's happened is we get a lot of these images, and then they almost become cartoonish to people, where they just dismiss them right away. And so I think a lot is going on with this idea of demons. I think you have, if you look at the very ancient depictions of them, I think if you were to sort of analyze those on their own, you might find different reasons for why they look the way they do. There's a lot of similarities, whether this is from diffusion or if it's just simply that people have all had a similar experience and they're trying to sort of communicate this in a way. And I think that may be one of the reasons why there's a lot of similarity there. But again, what happens is now we have sort of cartoonish figures of it, and, you know, devil with pitchfork. And so I think there's a disconnect now between the idea of what is a demon and what isn't, particularly the idea of shape-shifting. I mean, if these are things that if people are looking at in germ theory, are we really to think that if you looked into a microscope and perhaps saw the demon, would they look like little red devils? You know, probably not. So, I mean, I think when you have such conflicting information going back and forth, it's hard for people to wrap their minds around the possibility of there being demonic entities. So they'll just discount it altogether, which I think is a big mistake.
And the images are images of, really, it seems to me, of our fears. And they look frightening to us because they, you know, this is what frightful things look like to human beings, and we've sort of made them that way. But something is there. There's little question in my own mind about that. There can't be, because I live with something all the time, and a lot of my listeners do too. We're definitely involved in this in some way. Are we involved with demons or not, though? And that is a really, really important question, because what we are involved with, what I am involved with, is absolutely real. It is real. It is not in any way a form of folklore or imagination. Now, we're going to take another little break for our Free Dreamlanders, and we're going to get back into this a little more deeply, as you may imagine, when we get back.
The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
I want to tell you a little bit about my book, The Path. It came to me very suddenly one day in the mid-70s, before I had had any close encounter experiences or was even very much aware of any of this. I was in the Gurdjieff Foundation at the time, and I was fooling around with a deck of tarot cards, and suddenly this remarkable path emerged, and I understood the cards deeply. I grabbed on to the idea and put it down on paper. I'm actually holding the paper I put it down on in my hands right now, now an old yellow piece of typing paper with notations all over it. And it eventually became the path, a lay of the tarot cards that shows the path of life. And it's in the little book, The Path. It's now available as an ebook. You can go and get it on Strieber.com or on Amazon.com. Just search on The Path, Strieber, and it'll come up, or anywhere ebooks are sold. It's $3.99. And if you do get it and you have any questions, please write me at Whitley@Strieber.com, and I'll be glad to engage with your questions as best I can. As time goes on, I begin to see the path more and more as a really important contribution in my body of work. It's not about using the cards for divination exactly. It's more about using the cards to understand in a very deep way how to live the path of life. It's something that more and more I find myself going back to. There's a lot of value there, I feel. So go take a look at Strieber.com, The Path.
We're talking to Dr. Heather Lynn, Evil Archaeology, Demons, Possessions, and Sinister Relics. Her website is drheatherlynn.com. She's a professional historian and describes herself, I think, accurately as a renegade archaeologist on the quest to uncover the truth. Because looking at the past through the lens of our secular world isn't enough. It doesn't enable us either to understand the past, to explain the past, or to face things that they understood and knew and lived with that are still real. Now, I live with those things. I live with them. Most recently, I had a direct contact with what I call the visitors. It was about three nights ago. I meditate with them at 11 and at 3 every morning. And if I don't get up at 3, they will wake me up every time. Once in a blue moon, they let me sleep through the night, but not generally. This is a very fruitful relationship for me. It is a valuable relationship. But it has in the evidence some very, very dark stuff. And I have endured a lot from it. It hasn't been all sweetness and light. They're not Mr. Nice Guys. They're tough. Tough. Now, Heather, having listened to all of that, how does this description that I've just given relate to your understanding of what a demon is?
I think it's spot on. I think that, again, when we use terms like demon, it sort of conjures that Christian religious idea that we all agree are, well, these are terrible. You know, this is, we all think we know what they are. But what I found in my research, not just with evil archaeology, but my research into things like the Anunnaki, I believe what we're experiencing and what people now are experiencing in contemporary times, I think it's sort of the same thing. I think we're all having these experiences that the ancestors had, that people throughout all civilizations had. It's just that the way we describe them, the cultural connotations we give them, that those are the things that are different. But I think when you strip it all down, we're all having a very shared and real human experience that we're trying to understand. And it's very difficult to understand. And then a lot of these semantics get in the way. So things that are characterized as, say, elves or aliens or guides or even helpers or demons, these things, you know, I believe they're all part of the same thing. And so if you think of demons as being, you know, just pure evil, well, then maybe, you know, that's not really an accurate assessment. But if you think of demons in the way that the ancients thought of demons, they weren't pure evil. They had evil capabilities, just like people would. They could have good capability. They were sort of, they were advisors, but they could also be tricksters. And it would take a very astute person to be able to sort of navigate that. And sometimes they weren't able to do that. And so I think what we're looking at is something that is, for lack of better term, in my personal opinion, and I don't have a lot of science to back this up, but this is just my speculation, is that this has to do with something interdimensional, something that is completely on a different plane of reality, but that it's a shared experience. And in some of my work, I've looked at people who have experiences with DMT and these clockwork elves or machine elves, people who do a lot of meditation and can tap into these guides and helpers. Some would say these were demons. Others would say they were spirit guides. What are they? I think everyone's trying to answer that question. So I think that everybody's experiences and contributions to this are very important and valuable and need to be heard so that we can sort of wrap our heads around what is happening. What is this phenomenon? Because the more we just say, you know, it's a devil with a pitchfork, you know, the less we'll really understand about it. Likewise, if we say, well, they're all just the grays, or they're just, you know, elves or whatever, then you're just minimalizing and trivializing it, and we're not going to get to that greater truth that I feel is the common thread throughout all of the human experience from the beginning of consciousness to now.
From the beginning of consciousness until now, you know, Terence McKenna once said, we are part of a symbiotic relationship with something which disguises itself as an extraterrestrial invasion so as not to alarm us. And that resonates deeply with me because I know that this has been with us for a long time. I know that there are a lot of ways of looking at it. And I know that when you do look at it, you find gods, you find demons, you find the fairy folk, you find all of this. But that's not what's there. Something is there, though. And you know that. I know you do. And I know it. But the difficulty is, how do we talk about it? How do we talk beyond the way, deeper than what it appears to be?
Exactly. I think this is one of the biggest problems we have right now that's facing us, especially with, you know, people who are looking for disclosure and this idea, or disclose what? I mean, we have to kind of have a better grip about like what it is that we're looking for. And I think that what you said is exactly right. There's so much still that needs to be asked that is not being asked. And this is sort of where my research goes into sort of that, for lack of better term, maybe more the darker aspects of this experience.
So can you tell us a little bit more about that? When you say that your research goes into the darker aspects of the experience, can you take us a little ways down that path? I know we've been sort of doing that, but there's more, folks. Go ahead.
There's definitely more. So, as we talked about the beginning of consciousness, this sort of idea of what has happened, why do we humans have a consciousness? What is consciousness? You know, some have even named this the event of coming into consciousness, the big brain bang, and some people just call it the leap. And so this is a monumental event in the structure of the human brain that, you know, some people believe may have something to do with either ingestion of mind-altering substances or something to that effect. Other people have thought that it had to do with cooking your food. I mean, there's countless different theories and these sorts of things, but something did happen, and it's in my research, something that I found is that it doesn't seem to be by accident. It was so fast, for one thing. And then you look at just not just the structure of the brain and how it just so quickly changed beyond what we could look at now as adaptation or evolution. What you then have is this, what they call in academia, the Sumerian problem. The Sumerian problem being what happened in this area of the world to where, you know, there were bands of hunter-gatherers, and then all of a sudden somebody from somewhere else appeared. And then in the span of 200 years, which is nothing compared to, you know, human culture and this, it's just a blink of an eye. In 200 years, you go from being hunter-gatherers to having full cities and language and astronomy and all the aspects of high culture and civilization. So there's something, you know, that these cultures have this thing in common then. And it's that they talk about these seven sages. They speak of these, you know, extraterrestrial beings, or otherworldly. And they're not always extraterrestrial. That's something important to consider, is in some cultures, they come from inside the planet. You know, so it could be a number of things. Either way, they're from somewhere else. And they come and they advise. They usually advise the shamans, sometimes the rulers, and they guide things. And most of the time, they give technology. And the technology is good and things are great for a while until it's not. And sometimes these entities will get people in high places like the elites to do things. Maybe, you know, like nobody writes for free. So what you'll start to see is in some of these ancient cultures, mass human sacrifice, ritualistic abuse and bloodshed and suicidal tendencies and just all these terrible things. So it's a little dark, and it's something that, you know, I've been looking into a little more lately to sort of see if I can find that common thread. But it is something that I believe is associated or connected to some of the events that people experience to this day. And of course, not all of them, but there do seem to be some similar threads, at least with the encounters aspect of it. Some of the ways people describe these beings, some of the gifts they bring. And some of the ways that they can actually be helpful and maybe not so hurtful. But then again, some of them can seem helpful and then become hurtful. And so it's just this common narrative that we find, and everybody has a very unique experience of it. It's as though they're engaging in a relationship, a natural relationship that's not easy to define and say, well, this was bad or this was good. It's more complex than that. But it becomes a relationship and not just an encounter after a while. I think that's something that you maybe will relate to, that it's not just simply, oh, this happened to me once. It's, no, this is an ongoing relationship and something now that I have to understand as a part of my life. And that's something that the ancients shared as well.
It's a very, very good, very interesting answer. And I want to repeat that you can go to her website, to Dr. HeatherLynn.com, and get her free ebook. It's worth doing. It's really worth getting into Dr. Lynn's work. She obviously knows a lot of about this. This is deep thinking here, and I'm very grateful for it. I'm glad you're on the show. Her new book is Evil Archaeology, Demons, Possessions, and Sinister Relics. Now, it's always assumed that things like demons are sort of, or gods, or whatever you want to, whatever direction you want to go in, are sort of distant from us. They're not, in other words, you might look at a picture of a demon, or you might think of it as a spiritual being, not a physical being. But is that really the case always? Could there be physical manifestations? And the reason I ask is that I have had physical entities in my life that literally exuded evil. In fact, to give you an idea of how physical, a group of them turned up living in an apartment next to a condo my wife and I had in Texas, in San Antonio. I've written about this. And they were bizarre. They were not normal. They exuded an atmosphere of evil that was appalling. And they terrified everybody in the condo complex. And it turned out that they didn't even belong there. And the owner of the condo had to have them evicted by the sheriff, whereupon they went around the condo complex where everyone knew what they were being evicted and everything, trying to sell his furniture to us. And they started out behind my cabin, living behind my cabin in upstate New York. One of them did. And this was no ordinary person. He could read minds. He was horrifying. They all three of them were. Now, how do you resonate with this? I'm not asking you the impossible question of explain who these are, but you must have, with all of your study of this whole negative manifestation of being, that's what I would call it, you must have some things you could say about that.
Sure. I mean, I think that kind of goes back maybe a little bit towards the idea of thought forms, which it maybe isn't the best word for it either, but it's an older term because thought form kind of implies that it's just a thought or it's in your head. But I think the more important, you know, thing from that is form. It's something that is an idea, something that would be unseen or spiritual or, you know, of that nature that then becomes a form, takes form. And it's not just that it's a figure or a shadow person, but that if the intent and the power and the force is strong enough that it can materialize into an actual tangible, touchable, observable thing or form. And so I think that really gives, you know, to me that satisfies that idea. Well, then how could these things actually manifest or move something? You know, hear people who are thrown across the room, physically picked up and thrown across the room. Well, if it's just an invisible force, I mean, sure, maybe that, but then how is it that, you know, people can touch these entities to, you know, they can reach out and feel this. And so this is something that I think, again, has to do with the level of power and the force and the will behind it, the intent. So in my view, it's probably something more of a thought form. Now, whether that thought form is, and I think this is important to consider, because again, when you think of thought forms, it's in the occult literature, it'll talk about maybe an individual occultist who's just summoning these things and whatnot. But if you think about just on just the theoretical possibility and the power of that mechanism and get that individual occultist out of the question, if you consider that for a minute, it means that not just an individual can make a thought form, but what about the will and the intent and the feelings of a mass of people? Could they not make a thought form? Or could another off-world intelligence, if all it takes is a will and then the power of that will and intent, how are we not to think that, you know, it's something even bigger? So, you know, a lot of people have said that our reality is a computer simulation. Well, then could these things be, you know, a thought form of whoever is doing the simulating? I mean, there's so many different levels to this, but if you just take that idea that something, an intelligence, a consciousness could put forth some sort of intent with such force and such will behind it that it can eventually manifest and strengthen to become something in the physical form that is very real and tangible, then I think that explains it enough in my mind to at least make it possible.
Well, you know, it may sort of go in the direction of explaining it for a very strange reason. These beings, creatures, people, smoked constantly. The short There was one that was short that looked like, when I first saw him in my woods, I thought he was a child, an 11-year-old boy, but he was obviously something very different. And the reason I was concerned about him at first, because he was sitting near some trees called pitch pines, which could burst into flames in a moment, and he was smoking, and he was looked like a child, and I thought, you know, I better get him out of there. When I got close to him, he looked more like someone who had reached the age of 11 and then just weathered for God knows how long. And he growled at me, and it was terrifying. And Ann and I began to find places in the woods where he had lingered, and there would be like 24 cigarette butts around there. Unfortunately, this was before DNA testing existed in any significant way, and we never thought to collect them and get them DNA tested. I wish now we had, or could have. We couldn't actually do it then. And in any case, he would come up to the house sometimes, and we used to skinny dip. We had a very private swimming pool in our upstate New York cabin, and we would skinny dip there sometimes. And one night when we were skinny dipping, he began running up and down in the woods. You couldn't see him because the foliage was too dense, gasping and breaking sticks and making all kinds of noise in there. And like he didn't want us out there naked. And so we went back in the house and, you know, we just never did it again. Then we went down to move down to Texas, and lo and behold, about a week after we moved there, there he is standing in a little cul-de-sac beside the bedroom of our condo, which is on the ground floor, smoking cigarettes all night, and like right beside my head. And I could feel his mind inside my mind. It was appalling. And then he began to roam around the condo complex, and people saw him climb a wall, and then he pulled the spokes out of somebody's bicycles on the second floor of the condo on their deck. And people called social services because it was obvious that there was a feral child involved. And that's how it all started, and we ended up with these two horrible men. And let me tell you something else there. I saw them in the local drugstore, one of them, pick up in his arms packages of cigarettes, pipe tobacco, any kind of smoking material from their smoking section, and walk out with it in his arms, not even in a bag, with this look of ferocious sort of shared evil on his face when he locked eyes with me for a few seconds. And the clerks in the store just stood there like they weren't seeing it.
Wow. That's now, chilling.
Now, I don't think that was a thought form, is what I'm getting at. I think it was something real. And I think these things can manifest entirely independently of us, is what I'm saying.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yes, yes. No, I do believe that. I think that thought form in the context of what I'm saying is not necessarily that one person just sort of imagined it. I think that the thought form concept itself can possibly be one that allows for a figure to manifest in a very real way, but maybe they started not real, if that makes sense. So they just appear, but they're real. So they didn't necessarily have a birth and a child's and upbringing, but that they can sort of just be there. And likewise,
yeah, I can't imagine anything like what I saw being born to a woman. I mean, it's inconceivable, frankly.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of woman would have a child like that?
Rosemary.
Yeah, well, yeah, I mean, maybe, right. Maybe there are a lot of rosemaries out there who don't even know they're rosemaries until it happens. And then, of course, the entity completely controls the whole family, and nobody ever knows it's really there until it grows up and gets out.
Right. And these things have very real, tangible, you know, as you said, you went out and you saw cigarette butts and things, and this wasn't
We saw him. He was smoked. We saw him. I mean, we didn't just see the things he left behind. We saw him, and we saw the other two people. They were entirely physical, and they were living in a condo together. They were physical.
Yeah. Wow.
But they were also supernatural.
I think that could make sense though, because again, I think a lot of times we want to make it, you know, generally people like to separate the two, that it's only mind or spirit or body, but that none of those sort of interact, which I think is not true. I think that it can be both or one or not. I think it's the nature of reality is just,
you know, I think that
we're able to articulate
that something very dark conceals itself from us in our disbelief that this is a trick. You talk about tricksters. I think that as a species, we have been tricked, especially in the Western world, into believing that something that is very real and is very much part of this world isn't. You know, years ago, Anne and I and Shirley MacLaine used to spend a lot of evenings together talking. And Shirley had an idea that Annie didn't like, but I did. And I thought it was a fascinating idea that basically when you look up at the universe, look out at the stars, what you see are lights, but they are completely surrounded by darkness. In fact, we wouldn't even know the universe was there if there wasn't darkness. And Shirley's sense was that the darkness wants to recapture the silence that it remembers from the time before the universe existed. And this is all of these manifestations go back to that. How do you resonate with an idea like that?
Oh, that's a fascinating idea. I'll say that. I think it's as good an idea as any, but wow, that's very profound, very beautiful and poetic at the same time. But it could be that it's some sort of, way to bring the chaos back into some order, or at least the perceived chaos. And it goes back to, we mentioned the Terence McKenna and those sorts of topics. And, they did some research on people who took, DMT or had these experiences, and they thought that when they looked at the MRI of the brain while somebody would be on these substances, that the brain would be lit up with all kinds of activity, because you think of visions and these things as manifestations of just the brain and it's just hyperactive. But what they found was the opposite, that it actually deadened our ability to do what humans do, which is make order out of the chaos that's around us. And so it leaves me to wonder if, that's something similar, that all around us there is this activity, the supernatural world, all of these things that our brain is just working nonstop to filter and alter our perception of reality, because we won't be able to handle the truth that is right before our eyes.
You know, I think you have said that better than anyone else in the history of this show. I think that's the truth. I think you hit the nail absolutely on the head. On the head. I think that's exactly what's going on. I think we have turned ourselves into filtering mechanisms because we don't want to see where we really are and what is around us. And it doesn't want us to see that either. As Terence put it, so as not to alarm us. Well, I do see, and I am damn alarmed. Of course I'm alarmed. Yeah. On the one hand. On the other hand, the people I meet with at night, that like last night at 3, are fabulous teachers. And that's a subtext in this that you touched on a little bit earlier on. And I want to know what your thinking is, because there is in the dark, you do find knowledge if you know how to look for it. And to someone like me and like many of my listeners who is literally physically face to face with this now, what do you say about how we channel this energy in such a way that it's beneficial for us?
That's an excellent question, because I think we may be able to do that. I know of people who have been able to do that. And if you were to say credit human advancement in technology with this sort of ancient wisdom or current wisdom, this channeled wisdom, then you could see some absolute benefit. You could definitely say, well, this has great benefit. The question is how do we then benefit from it and not fall into something more sinister? I think that starts with the self, that we as individuals need to be able to have better antenna. Like, so if we are able to channel into this sort of chaotic realm of communication, and it's like a radio. So if we want to hear the negative, you know, we can fine tune it to that negative. And I think it might be easier to do that when the negative is so strong and so trying to penetrate and maybe darken our light. What we may have to work harder to do is, you know, fine tune our own ability to tune in and tap into the positive and be able to at least face it. I think first thing, we have to face it and not sort of turn the radio off and just let something, you know, turn it on at will. I think we need to be more in control of, you know, our minds and our consciousness and try to do it without fear. It is a very scary thing. And so it's easier said than done, but I think fear leaves us vulnerable to the negative. And it's something that, you know, in the context of light and dark, it is the dedication that I actually have in Evil Archaeology. I say, for those who fear what isn't known, let light reveal what isn't shown. And I mean that light as in we need to be more open and responsive to light and try to recognize it when we see it. But I think that given the chaos, given all of the noise out there, I think we just have to try our very best to filter what we can and look at things in a way that isn't just our negativity projected out or whatever. I mean, it's a very difficult thing. It's easier said than done. But I do think that some of the onus is on us. I mean, you have that with occult, you know, figures or people who are looking to specifically tap into just the negative. That's what they're trying to do. That's what they want to do. And oftentimes they're successful. So I think if any of this has to do with intent, then we need to very much make sure that our intent is as pure as can be and that we walk in the light to the best of our ability.
Dr. Heather Lynn, her website, drheatherlynn.com, where you can get a free ebook for starters. Get into this. Evil Archaeology, Demons, Possessions, and Sinister Relics. We've talked to a wise woman today, folks. We have talked to a wise woman who managed to see beyond the bizarre weirdness of so many of our lives. The demons of the distant past are not gone. They are still part of the human world and part of us. And finding the light in that context is the path that is the true path for us. Thank you so much for being with us, Dr. Heather Lynn on Dreamland.
Thank you so much for having me.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.